today's popular mythology, the 1950s are looked on as happy days, a time of fond nostalgia. For those charged with our nation's defenses, though, nothing could have been further from the truth. The chill of the Cold War had reached an icy low. There was a massive arms buildup in the Eastern Bloc, and our traditional information gathering methods were being cut off by a tightly drawn iron curtain. Adding to the temper of the times was a requirement to overfly certain areas of the world and ascertain the character and strength of their military development. In early December of 1954, operating under an approval granted by President Dwight Eisenhower, the task of creating such a craft was assigned to Premier Designer Kelly Johnson and his team from Lockheed's Advanced Development Projects Division, more popularly known as the Skunk Works. From the start, the new aircraft, simply called the U-2, was up against the wall. Since computers were still in their infancy, they would be of little help. The fledgling bird would mostly come together as an amalgam of slide rule technology mixed with experience and foresight. Even more critical, though, was the time factor. Johnson had promised to go from paper to prototype in just 8 months, a schedule that would turn even the most ardent optimist pale. Yet, laboring around the clock, under a cloak of secrecy and a philosophy which simply stated, give a man a job, don't tell him how to do it, then give him the authority and encouragement to do it right, a small group of people began to turn the near impossible into reality. On August 6, 1955, the date of the U-2's first flight, there were no brass bands, press conferences, or reporters present. Just a small group of weary, dedicated men to witness an event that would forever change the course of strategic reconnaissance and have a profound effect on world history. With Johnson double-checking every minute detail, the first aircraft was completed on schedule. Almost from the moment of liftoff, it exceeded expectations and specifications. Because nothing in the U.S. flying arsenal in the 1950s could safely fulfill the mission requirements, the U-2 had to be different, and it was. With its long 80-foot glider-like wings and gently tapering 49-foot fuselage, the design represented a radical departure from anything in the sky at the time. Following in less than a year, the U-2 took off on its first operational mission. Although the details remain classified, it was later described as brilliantly successful. More operations soon followed with similar results. Until a fateful May 1st day in 1960. It brought a young pilot, Francis Gary Powers, to world prominence.